had to do some divining.
Right.
Welcome to Conversations with Barbara. This is Barbara Kanellopoulos, and I am here today with Melinda Ponder, who has written a new biography of Falmouth's own Katharine Lee Bates. Thank you so much for coming to Falmouth to talk to us about your book. Yes.
Well, I'm always delighted to be in Falmouth, where, of course, was so important to Katharine growing up that we'll talk about, I'm sure.
Yes, yes, yes. Everyone knows she was born here, and she is our Falmouth treasure. What inspired you to write this very long book?
Well, when I was in grade school and came home singing America the Beautiful, my Wellesley College mother told me very proudly that someone at her college had written America the Beautiful. And when I asked if she knew her, she said, well, no. Of course, she was much older than that. And I wasn't too interested, since she hadn't even known her. And I didn't realize why this was amazing, that a woman had written this song. So, and I then went to Wellesley myself, sang America the Beautiful. Often, all four verses at step singing. But that was not enough to get me interested in her. Until later, when I was a college professor myself and a Nathaniel Hawthorne scholar, having written two books on him, I found that she had written introductions to a big centenary edition of Hawthorne. Mm-hmm. And I was on a panel with three other Hawthorne scholars. We singled hers out as the very best. In my case, I was very interested that she was writing about Hawthorne's women, the women in his family, the women in his fiction, and I thought this was sort of a basic feminist criticism, really. And she had a lively style because, as I later learned, she was a popular writer who wanted to sell what she wrote. So I went out to Wellesley to see, I thought, how could this be the same person who wrote America the Beautiful, who was such an excellent scholar of Hawthorne?
Yes, and such a lively writer.
Yes, yes, how could this be? Since I knew I was a professor struggling along just to do my teaching, how could she possibly have done this other writing? So I got out to the archives and found here were her letters, her diaries, and these scrapbooks that she and her brother had carefully pasted every last little piece of poetry or a short story into that she'd published over the years that were not part of the 30 books that she had written or edited. So I was hooked, really. And so I started my research then, really.
Your just reminds me that I read in your book that she has written a poem to Rose Hawthorne.
Yes, yes. So, wasn't that so nice?
Yes, very nice, very nice. And now, Katharine Lee Bates seems to be quite different from what we might think of a patriotic woman who wrote that song. And so what stands out in your mind about that makes her really a surprise to readers?
Well, I guess I felt, as I was working on the book, I felt that I was really interested in how she became a good writer, the story of her development starting in Falmouth. Mm-hmm. And then I saw that as I learned more about her life when she went to Wellesley as a student, and then later when she went back to Wellesley to be on the faculty, she was surrounded by all these young women who were social activists.
Yes.
And they wanted to change the world. And that had been the founder of Wellesley's motto for the college. Not to serve, not to be served, but to serve in the sense of bringing about real reform in the country after the Civil War. So I realized that she had become a social activist really because of this group of friends she had at Wellesley. And they pulled her right into the real world, even though she might have preferred to be in her tower writing poetry.
Right, yes.
So she became much more interesting to me that way.
But, you know, it seems to me that some of her fiction, she probably had a humanitarian spirit.
Yes.
That so that her friends, it seemed to me, they were all pretty compatible.
Yes.
Because much of her work has a human interest.
That's right. Well, and I think a lot of that really was thanks to Falmouth. Falmouth should be very proud of her
because
it was here that, here was this community, this was she was born right before the Civil War. Here was this community, many of widows from because of the maritime careers, of course, of their husbands, or because of the war. And her mother was widowed right after, a month after she was born, leaving her mother with these four small children. Mm-hmm. And so Katharine grew up in an environment where everybody shared whatever they had.
Right. Isn't that their line? Socialism.
Yes, she called Falmouth a village practicing neighborly socialism before they knew that term.
Yes.
But her mother shared with the people who needed it, who came to her doorway too. And so Katharine grew up seeing a community function together. And I think that was always her ideal. Mm-hmm. And of course, there's the wonderful poem she wrote about when Lincoln died, remembering seeing at the church on the green the widow's shawls decorating, because there hadn't been enough black material at the little store in Falmouth to go around the church. The church was draped then with the widow's shawls, and she saw her mother's, and she felt connected to the rest of the country.
Right. And that was our own congregational church on Main Street.
Right on, right on the village green.
Yes, yes.
And another thing that I think I found researching Falmouth was that this was a village of people who went around the globe in these ships. And so they may have been not connected by even railroad then to Boston, but they faced the oceans that brought them all these treasures that people brought home from their trips, including, I read, her brother Arthur wrote that he owned a curtain rod in his adult life in Portland, Maine, that had belonged to a South Sea boy that these captains would bring back these young boys to learn English to the Falmouth schools for several years. And this boy had given his spear to Arthur, Catherine's brother.
Really?
So there was all this evidence that Falmouth was part of a global world, a global community.
Yes, hardly a provincial life.
Right,
really.
That's right.
Yeah,
that's
so interesting. And it's really important, I think, that she never came from money. She didn't come from money and never had money, so that she always had to worry about providing for herself as a single woman.
That's right. The family were all well-educated.
Yes.
She had grandfathers and all who were many ministers in the family and all. And her mother and aunt had been sent to Mount Holyoke Seminary.
Right. Her mother was a teacher.
Yes, her mother had been a teacher. Her mother was a brilliant woman who really had great ambitions for Katharine.
Yes, yes. So that she struggled to, perhaps she would have preferred to have spent all of her time writing, but she had to teach
because
she needed that steady income.
That's right.
Right, right.
That's right.
And also, it must be said that there was this awful prejudice coming from men of education about the role of women. It seems to me that she must have felt that as a burden.
Well, I think that because she'd grown up in this village really of many women running everything probably, and a household with the mother and the aunt.
Widowed, yes.
Then she went to Wellesley, of course, women's college that the founders dedicated to educating women so that, as I said, they could change the country. They felt that after the Civil War, so many men had been killed. That meant that all the schools were going to need good teachers, and these were going to be the women that they felt they were educating. Mm-hmm. And so she did, I think she had a strong confidence in herself. And she had many men who were her mentors.
The founder of Wellesley.
Longfellow,
yes.
And then editors she had. Right. And so she was able, we would say today, maybe to navigate the worlds of the all-women.
Yes, and you know, it strikes me too that she was an intellectual, so she lived the life of the mind.
Yes.
And her other the men that you say were mentors also were living the life of the mind, so there was a kind of equality there.
That's right. Yeah. And the two men who courted her.
Yes,
of
that's,
course.
That's true. Well, since you mentioned that, let's talk about her. Katharine Lee Bates had a romantic life.
Yes, yes, I discovered that she had two male suitors. One, Oscar Triggs, when she was spending her year at Oxford University in England, who, if Oscar was a big social reformer and interested in, believed in free love and real radical. And I think he gave her companionship and educated her more about the social ideals and also gave her some romance. When she came back after that year, I think she did not hear from him, no matter what he might have promised or led her to believe. And then she had a second suitor, Theophilus Root, brother of one of her classmates. And he too, he was training for the ministry, as Oscar had been. Oscar then went on to become a professor of literature at the University of Chicago. So Theophilus shared her, well, I guess her background, really, and had her interests too. But unfortunately, he could not support her. He was behind her in his career at the time.
Right, right.
And she couldn't have continued on at Wellesley on the faculty if she
were
married.
Married women could not
teach.
That's
right. That's right. So she would have had trouble finding any kind of a job that would have satisfied her after she had been at Wellesley and had a good professorship, because the men's colleges weren't hiring women professors.
I see. So she had these constraints that the sort of, it's rather sad that, but it was a life.
That's right. That's right. It's like anybody's life. Yes, we all have, compromises.
Yeah, exactly.
And she then had the companionship of Catherine Coleman and later Caroline Hazard, who was president of Wellesley, women who shared her interests, and she did a lot of traveling with them. One of the great joys of my research.
Yes, she went to Egypt.
That's right. Yeah. Not only did I go up on top of Pike's Peak, of course, to see what she had seen.
You mean to say that in doing your research, you went to where Catherine went?
Yes, I went everywhere that I could that she went to.
How exciting.
Well, I learned, having been to Colorado but not to Colorado Springs, that then when I got to Colorado Springs and found it was a spa town based on Little London, you know, and then I went over to see Cripple Creek, the gold mining town, that I did need to go to all these places that she'd live. Of course, I love going to England. Then I went to Spain, following her, some of the places that she went to, and then on a different trip, I went to Egypt, where she had gone.
Well, that
so
I must,
it was. It made I, it. It made it her much more real to me.
It did. Well, it made her makes her much more real to your readers. Because I felt as I was reading this that I could see her not just the milieu, but the whole, the era, what was going on at the time, what she found at Colorado Springs, the newness of it. And when she rents a room in Boston, you describe Boston and what that was like at the time. And so I think all of that historical, those descriptions, made her come alive for me, and I'm sure that it will be for readers as well.
Good. Well, she loved traveling. I mean, I would attribute that to Falmouth too. As she said, the tide is calling, the anchors lift. You know, and so she loved traveling, and that was another part of her life that I didn't know anything about.
Now, she was also very outspoken. Some of her poetry was very critical of a growing imperialism that she didn't care for.
Yes.
She scolds Great Britain in one poem for the Boer War.
Right.
And so without any reticence, she's very outspoken. Perhaps she thought because she built these into her poetry, it might have been. No, I think it was pretty overt.
Well,
clear.
The anti-Boer War poet, remember, she wrote under the name of Lincoln.
That's right, J. Lincoln.
Yeah. She adopted that name and adopted this companion that she needed at the time,
right.
Both a probably a lover, companion, mentor, right, sometimes son,
yeah,
and definitely a writer who was getting published. And so, yeah.
What an interesting woman.
That's really right.
Interesting.
That's right. And she, I think the longer I did this research over many years, since I was chairman of an English department myself at a women's college, Pine Manor, and that was another thing that I thought I could bring to the book, was my own sort of inside knowledge of what she felt like when she said, oh, she hated to leave the golf course for a faculty meeting.
Right. Right.
You know,
right.
That she became more and more complex. The more I researched, the more complicated she became, which was a good thing. I mean, made me want to tell all the stories about her.
Now, I found some of the diary entries were, I use the word oblique. I would read them and think, well, what does she mean? And yet you interpret, and that's because you knew what was going on around the time that she made that entry.
Right.
That must have been difficult.
Well, you know, it's a very long process, doing the research and then trying to kind of construct the chronology day by day from the diary, but then I have all the publication dates to work into that chronology and other people's letters to her and what was going on at the college, what was she teaching at the time, et cetera.
I see. So you put all that together then.
Tried to sense, but for instance, she suffered from depression, understandably. Mm-hmm. And when she wrote in the one entry episode of the carving knife, you know, that probably meant that this was a suicidal thing, but I didn't want to say, well, she picked up the knife and did this.
Did that,
I mean, I felt
right.
that I could just put the quote there for readers to understand how she was feeling.
Right. And there are so many other interesting things, too. Chloroform.
Yes, that's a good example.
I meant to do
that
some research.
That is a good example.
Find out.
I think she took chloroform to go to sleep. She had insomnia all her life, and she'd written the famous poem that Longfellow complimented on sleep about a sleepless night. And I think that chloroform, when she just was overwhelmed by things, that was a way of getting to sleep.
Right, right. So your book has plenty of these little things too. It seems to me that maybe chloroform was a common remedy for sleeplessness in those days until perhaps it was discovered that it was too dangerous.
Right, that's right.
Right.
That's right. Well, and chloroform also, I suppose, could have been fatal.
That's right.
So
that's
we don't know about that.
Now, we must talk about the fact that America the Beautiful was not written once and for all. She was a poet and used to rewriting, and I suspect that changing events in our country's history prompted some of the changes that she made. I love the pages in your book where you do, I called it deconstructing, and you do, and that's very important for people to see the importance of the wording and the changes in wording.
That's right. Well, she went up on Pikes Peak in 1893 during the country's dreadful depression and a lot of class warfare, labor riots, etc. And she didn't publish it for two more years, 1895. Then in the years that intervened before she revised it in 1904, and the 1904 version is close to what we sing today with the words about brotherhood. Those words had not been in before. So I needed to find out what was going on that made her change this.
Yes.
So I did a lot of research into the American events, the political events at the time. I used a lot of newspaper headlines to kind of bring this to life for readers. And then, of course, I knew about the Spanish-American War, and that's she'd gone over as the first female foreign journalist to go to Spain right after that war. But still, there were more years, and that's when I learned about the Filipino-American War, a war I'd never heard about, really. And one day, when I was working in the Wellesley Archives, Wilma Slate, the archivist, came in and said, oh, here was something interesting that she thought I might like to see. And this was an account about a Filipino family, the Lopezes. and that Clemencio Lopez had been a guest at Wellesley College. Katharine Coleman had been her hostess, and one of the brothers had been jailed in this insurrection by American mm-hmm. and the American government. And so all of a sudden, this made this clear. This was when there was a lot of conflict in this country, especially in Boston, with the anti-imperialist group arguing against America taking over these countries, Puerto Rico, Cuba, the Hawaii, and then the Philippines. So it seemed to me, and this was also a period of a lot of lynching in our country.
Oh, yes.
And so it seemed to me that she added these words about brotherhood because she felt that if we were going to be the power over these countries, we should get our own house in order here and remember what our ideals were.
Yes.
So, of course, and then she has a final vision in my book that readers will have to see about her vision of America the Beautiful at the end.
Well, that's so important. I think knowing all that makes the America the Beautiful me more meaningful, because I know that those words were not just put there. They were thought through. They were important words.
That's right.
And and the other thing I think that is interesting to talk about too is the fact that she had to worry about making a living for herself, and that that she also had to make an important decision about her future life. She does say in one of you quote her talking about a marriage and motherhood has a kind of wisdom that mm-hmm. perhaps scholarship doesn't bring. Mm-hmm. But it seems to me that the life that she made for herself was every bit as rich as anyone else's. So out of all of those demands and constraints, she built herself a successful life.
She did. That's right. And I tried to make the final chapter of my book, the 10th chapter, showing I leaned on Erik Erikson's idea of the period of where we all try to see what we can leave behind the generations that follow from our careers. And that was when she began mentoring Robert Frost, knew Amy Lowell, helped start these big public poetry readings, and hosted all these people at this house, the Scarab, named after her Egyptian treasures. So she grew into and left that in a way. This was after Katharine Coleman had died. Now she was really alone. But she reached out and had this network of other poets, and then she brought along the younger poets and her students.
And that's very interesting, because it would show how, as an artist, how open-minded she was about other people's work.
Yes.
Her own poetry wasn't particularly modernist.
That's right.
And yet I think she saw the value in what these other American writers
were
doing.
That's right.
Her hospitality to Robert Frost was
I know, wasn't that
huge.
Something? Yes, yeah. yes, yes.
And
well, and
she
had written this textbook, American Literature, that was the first by a woman, first such textbook, and it was what today we would call far more inclusive than the other textbooks written at the time, including more women, more people of color, more people like Thoreau and Whitman, who were regarded as eccentric outsiders.
Yes,
then.
Yeah, that's interesting.
Yeah.
That's
really interesting. Yeah, she saw the value in their work.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think the book, we do want to tell viewers that you're going to be, there's a book launch here in Falmouth.
Yes.
And so tell viewers about that.
So on Katharine's birthday, Saturday, August 12th, I'm going to be launching, and I love this word in Falmouth and in the context of my life with Estrella.
Right.
I'm going to be launching my book at the Museums on the Green in Falmouth at 2 p.m. I'll be doing a talk and then book signing there afterwards.
And that's August 12th.
August 12th. That's right, Saturday the 12th.
Yeah, very good. And this is the book, From Sea to Shining Sea. This was based on a painting by Joseph Downs, who was a teacher of art in Falmouth High School. And there we have Katharine Lee Bates. It is just such a thrill to have this book. Thank you so much for being here to talk about the book, and I'll look forward to seeing you on the 12th.
Oh, good.
At the museums on the green, too.
Good. Thank you for having me.
Yes. And thank you for tuning in. We'll look forward to seeing you next time on Conversations with Barbara.